Okay, so we are presenting about the Uniform Commercial Code. I'm Adam Abraham.
I'm Fallon Hades.
I'm Dylan Marshall.
So what is the UCC? The UCC is a set of laws that provides legal rules and regulations governing commercial or business dealings and transactions. It standardizes business laws in the U.S. and seeks uniformity amongst the states. And the purpose of the UCC is to simplify, clarify, and modernize commercial law, to make business activities more predictable and efficient, and to promote consistency.
Article 1 is about general provisions. General provisions deals with the definitions as well as the rules of interpretation of the provisions. The general provisions apply as default rules covering transactions and matters of otherwise covered under a different article of the UCC. As other parts of the UCC have been revised and amended to accommodate changing business practices and developments in the law, these modifications need to be reflected in an updated article. Thus, Article 1 contains many changes of technical, non-substantive nature, such as reordering and renumbering sections, and adding gender-neutral terminology.
Article 2 deals with sales. So it's the sale of goods. So goods is defined as all things which are movable at the time of identification to the contract. So these are things such as tangible objects. So in intangible objects, Article 2 does not apply to, such as service contracts. During a sale of good, the title passes from seller to buyer. And there's special rules when there's a sale of good by a merchant. And a merchant is defined as a person who deals in goods of the kind or otherwise by his occupation, holds himself out as having knowledge or skill peculiar to the practices or goods involved in the transaction. So it's someone that has a high knowledge of his skill or occupation. So some examples are jewelers, carpenters, and plumbers. And the UCC was created to override the mirror image rule of commercial law, which states that each term in a contract the seller and buyer must agree on exactly. So this was created to help modern business today, because today the business environment is so fast-paced that oftentimes deals are closed and then some terms remain unopened because they couldn't agree on them. And before Article 2, that wasn't allowed. And so here's a case that deals with Article 2 of the UCC. It's Hammer versus Thompson. And Hammer originally placed 150 cattle with Thompson just on his pasture land for grazing. And Thompson took that as he was giving him possession of the cattle. So he went and converted the cattle and then sold it to Morris. And then that happened a couple more times, and it kept going through people. In the original case, Hammer was trying to argue that Thompson did not have possession of the cattle, and the first ruling was in Thompson's favor, so this case is actually Hammer appealing that ruling. And they look at the UCC entrustment doctrine, which says when goods are entrusted to the possession of a merchant who deals in goods of that kind, sale of those goods by the merchant transfers the entrustor's title to a buyer in the ordinary course of business. So it said that Thompson was a merchant, and Hammer did not dispute that he did deliver possession to Thompson, so when he appealed it, he lost again.
So Article 2A governs the true lease of goods. A true lease is an arrangement where the leaser bears both the risk and awards associated with owning property, and then the lessee merely gets to use the property in a rental fashion. Article 2A was added to the Uniform Commercial Code in 1987, and it was later amended in 1990, and responded to the large increase in leases during the 1970s. People started to like leases because they could like use property without actually having title or owning it. Then a big part of Article 2A is finance leases. A finance lease is considered a true lease in which the leaser is not the fundamental supplier of the goods. He just leases the goods to the lessee as a means of financing the lessee's acquisition of the goods. And there's three requirements for the agreement to be considered a finance lease, and it is the leaser cannot participate directly in manufacturing or selecting the goods. And the reason for this is if the lessee has a problem with the goods, if they're defective or something, he has to go right to the supplier because the leaser has nothing to do with that. And the last two requirements are the leaser's acquisition of the goods must be in relation to the lease. And then the last one is one of four methods must be used to give the lessee advance notification of any warranties or promises made by the supplier.
And then case James Fish versus Home Depot.
The plaintiff was consumer James Fish, and what he did is fell off in a ladder that was rented or leased to him by Home Depot. And he filed a claim, but he ended up losing because they said, or he said that the faulty ring caused him to fall, but the defendant was protected by the rental agreement.
Article 3 is about negotiable instruments. This applies to negotiable instruments such as promissory notes and checks. It does not apply to money, to payment orders governed by Article 4A, or to securities governed by Article 8. If there's a conflict between this article and Article 4 or 9, then Articles 4 and 9 govern. Negotiable instruments are very important to the economy, therefore Article 3 is necessary and so widely accepted. Notes and checks can be negotiable or non-negotiable, but negotiability is the issue that makes Article 3 essential. Negotiable means that a person can transfer the note or check to another person. A case for this one is Swift versus Tyson. Tyson was the defendant and bought land and paid for it with a bill of exchange. A bill of exchange is a promise to pay, but it's not due until a future date. The sellers of the said land did not own the land. The sellers assigned the bill of exchange to Swift, who is the plaintiff. On the due date, Swift brought it to Tyson and refused to pay because he never received the title to the land. And the court ruled in favor of Swift, who is the plaintiff, because the negotiable instrument was made with a lack of consideration. And since the negotiable instrument was written for land that the sellers didn't actually own, then the bill of exchange would be worthless to Swift.
Article 4 deals with bank deposits and collections, and it defines a bank as any person who deals in the business of banking. And there's a couple different bank characterizations, which the first one is depository, which is where the item starts out at, and then there's the payer bank, and that's where the item will be withdrawn, and the collecting bank is where the item will be collected. And so the depository collecting bank, when they receive an item for a collection, they don't normally advance it for cash right away. They wait until they have a final payment from the payer bank. There are certain circumstances where they will let a customer withdraw cash in a situation like that. It's when they know that the account has enough money in it to offset the balance if the check doesn't clear, or if there's a long trust relationship with the bank and the customer and stuff like that regularly happens. And to reflect any transaction, they make provisional entries into the customer's accounts.
So Article 4A governs the transfer of funds and establishes liabilities and remedies for errors made while the transfer is in progress. When Article 4A was added to the Uniform Commercial Code in 1989, there was no backstop statutory law in place. The rules for Articles 3 and 4 that dealt with checks and the signatures and endorsements on the checks determine liability, but that doesn't apply to Article 4A and funds transfers. So many transfers in the United States are affected through something called electronic transfer networks, and the two main ones are FedWire, which is owned and operated by the Federal Reserve, and CHIPS, which is owned and operated by the New York Clearing House. But these two systems have several rules to govern transactions between participating banks. They don't have any effect on the customers themselves. And so outside of FedWire and CHIPS, there are several, or they use common law contract rules are applied. But the problem is not a lot of people sit down and negotiate a contract for the transfer of funds. So a lot of transfers are made in actual legal void. So to demonstrate a quick transfer, unless the sender, the first sender, which is called the originator, and the beneficiary have the same bank, there would be four parties involved. And it's quite simple. The sender just communicates a payment order to the receiving bank, and then that receiving bank communicates a payment order to the other receiving bank, and then that receiving bank gives the money to the beneficiary or credits his account.
Article 5, letters of credit. Article 5 of the UCC sets rules for transactions involving letters of credit. A letter of credit is an instrument that participates in the payment system along with money, electronic funds transfers, and checks. Letter of credit is defined under Article 5 as an issuer giving credit to the beneficiary on behalf of an applicant. Often the issuer is a bank or financial institution, the applicant is a customer of the bank, and the beneficiary is who is doing business with the applicant who wants assurance. Payment requires presentation of a document, usually on behalf of the beneficiary to the issuer, And letters of credit are very important for international business and trade. Revisions to Article 5 have adapted to increase the international dealings by simplifying the rules.
Article 6 deals with bulk transfers and bulk sales, and it provides specific protection for creditors of businesses that sell merchandise from stock. And so a bulk sale is when a seller will sell the majority of their inventory to a single buyer. And Article 6 requires that they provide notice to the seller's creditors that they're not going to continue on in the same line of business or a similar business, because that would hurt those creditors.
So Article 7 deals with documents and title. So for centuries, businesses have been storing and shipping goods. And so some of these businesses are like warehousemen who own warehouses and allow people to store their stuff there. And then common carriers who bring stuff from place to place. So these businesses are visible, real, but what isn't is like how the title changes hands and the rights change hands. And so Article 7 addresses this issue with documents of title. And one big part of the Article 7 is negotiability. Documents and negotiability. Some documents can be negotiable, and the two main paper documents are order paper and bearer paper.
Article 8 deals with investment securities. It governs the ownership and transfers of these securities. An example of securities are stocks, bonds, mutual funds, limited partnership shares, and other business investment types. Before the UCC, a version of this article existed as the Uniform Stock and Transfer Act. The Uniform Stock and Transfer Act became Article 8 when the UCC was created. In the past, in order to buy a stock in a company, there was a time-sensitive transfer, and this involved the passing of a physical certificate to the purchaser. Once electronic transfers were present, uncertificated securities were added to Article 8.
Article 9 deals with secure transactions, and it provides the rules governing any transaction that couples debt with creditors' interest. And a creditor's interest is a security interest. And there has to be two things present, attachment and perfection. And there's an illustration here to kind of show what would go on. So there has to be a relation or an agreement between the debtor and the creditor. And the debtor's personal property that it has rights to is the collateral. And if the debtor defaults, the creditor is able to repossess that collateral and sell it. And that's their attachment to it.
So in conclusion, the Uniform Commercial Code is the longest and most elaborate of the Uniform Acts. And today, with businesses doing business in more than one state, by some businesses manufacture goods in one state and then store them in another state and then sell them in a different state and then deliver them in a different state, there's a lot of rules and regulations, and commercial transactions can become complex. The Uniform Commercial Code harmonizes state laws and brings uniformity.
Questions? And our website.